How's everyone doing? I like participation. I will be asking questions. I'll be picking on probably a few people. Farther back you are, the more I probably will pick on you. Yeah, right. I'll leave you alone. So, I'll start out by kind of introducing and spending a little time on what I do with and a project I'm working on. But while I'm getting the presentation up here, the question I want you to ponder on is, why the hell are you here this weekend? What are you doing here this weekend? Right? All right. As Jordan said, my name is Elliot Iannello. I am a co-owner and founder of Parable Game Studios. My friend from high school, Jesse, he's a really talented artist. Can't speak more highly of him. He's a brother to me. He and I started this studio a year ago. So this is, kind of an early anniversary, this talk and being here. I'm very grateful to be here with you guys today. We met in high school. We ran track together, and we both found out that we were both geeks at heart. And we love games, and we love art, and we decided, in college to kind of work together on a few games, and some of those were for Dr. Vanskoy when I had her as a teacher a couple times. And those projects turned into this company, and we're all about teaching, and we're all about simplicity. So Parable is a short, simple story that imparts a lesson or a moral. So we went with Parable. So that's what we do and what we're about. And our first game is coming out later this year. It's called Young Sun. And I'm trying to leave a little time at the end for some questions. Like I said, I like participation. I like to talk to people. So if you want to know more about that, we can do that later. But that's not the point of this talk. The point of this talk is the spark of life. And really hoping we can have a dialogue so I don't come off as too pretentious, because that's a slightly pretentious title. But it goes to the question I asked you while I was fumbling with my computer here. What are you doing here this weekend? Why are you here? Why are you here? I remember talking to you a while ago. Friendly face.
Well, I mean, to make a game.
To make a game. Why do you want to make a game?
It's a learning experience.
That's a pretty good answer. All right. That's a pretty good answer. Did we go dark? We went dark. My whole talk is about this one image. Everything that I think I need to get through it is all right here. So I'm really putting that age-old adage, a picture's worth a thousand words, to the test. This is the only slide. Does everyone know what this is? Okay. What's this from? Anyone? Shaking your head. Yeah, she got it. Yeah, the Sistine Chapel. Specifically, it's the fourth panel of the Genesis story, right? And whose hand's on the right? That's God's hand, and on the left is Adam. So this is the creation of Adam. Is the portion, this is a focal point of a much larger body of work, and it's pretty big. Early 1500s, right? He painted this. And I want to start with the hand on the right, right? Because that's you this weekend. Right? You guys are going to be creators. All right? And what was your name again? I'm sorry.
Destiny.
Beautiful. Beautiful name. Great game. All good. did I embarrass you? Sorry. as Destiny said, she's here to learn something. Think about the mind of the innate human desire to create. Right? We've been doing it really since we've been on the face of the earth, as history would tell us. I think one of those reasons we have this innate desire is to learn, right? We have a hunger for knowledge. Does anyone have any other ideas? Why do you like to create? Why do you like to create, Ty Guy?
I don't know. I came to this last year and
You had fun. Well, creating can be fun. It can be fun. What is fun?
That's a really complicated question.
It is a really complicated question. You should read A Theory of Fun by Raph Koster to get a more robust answer on that. But fun and work are really all, they're not that different mentally, right? One, you just assign an enjoyment to. You get pleasure out of it because you're passionate about it, right? So you find this fun because it's passionate work. Would you say that?
Yeah, I would.
All right. Do you think that, you know, in the story, in this tale, God creating Adam, you know, let's put ourselves in that position for a second. Why do you think God did that? I mean, God decided, I'm going to create. Well, to me, this notion of the waning of effect, anyone grapple with that for a second? This idea is proposed by an author named Frederick Jameson, the waning of effect. Life is mundane and boring when you're not creating it. If you're just going through the motions and you don't have a feeling, an emotion that's colorful, as we saw in the first presentation, then what's the point of it, right? Life's kind of drab without color. So to me, a big part of why we create is this combatance of the waning of effect. And I find it to be the duty of the creator to steward, delight, and imbue a lesson in the created, and then to let go of it. We went black again, didn't we? There we go. So, what are some qualities you think that make a good creator? You think game designer too? What are some good qualities? Let's go back to Ty Guy.
Passion.
Passion. Back of the room.
Originality.
Uniqueness is really important.
Empathy.
Empathy. Huge. I think something of note in this picture is the emphasis on the fingers, right? Going to the idea of uniqueness. Human finger, your finger is unlike anything else on the face of the earth. Even twins, identical twins, have slightly different fingerprints. So, how do you think that, we said uniqueness is an important characteristic of being a good creator. So I would argue, looking at the composition of the picture, there's fingers obviously on both sides, the creator and the created. Uniqueness is important on both sides. More on that in a second from the left side of the perspective. Let's stay on the right. This is your role. You're on the right this weekend, right? Why is it important to be unique as a game designer? What's the importance of that fingerprint? Kind of got to this on my... Exactly. Well, and even more so, you want to stand out. But do you think it's easier to make a game about something you know nothing about? Right? Design by proxy is crap. Design by experience is awesome. This should be a reflection of yourself. That's why this is art. So, and it should be taken just as seriously as the Sistine Chapel. And I think games are getting that respect. But, you know, maybe a little bit of a ways to go. But that design by proxy is combated directly when you embrace your uniqueness. And that is a clear characteristic, I think, that Michelangelo is packed into this painting, this visual, with the emphasis on the fingers. And I think what's really kind of cool is you'll see, you have the big, you know, you have Adam laying on the clouds and he's all like, oh, I'm alive. And then, you know, God's being all omnipotent. But a lot of times your eye is always drawn to just this point. It's the hands and what's in between them. So why create? And the other thing I think of, another reason I think we create is what I call the joy of witnessed flourishing. You want to make something compelling, and you want to see something that you've made, flourish in the world. You know, if we want to get all Freudian, that could be tied to our reproductive senses, but that's nonetheless beautiful, or nonetheless, you know, it's still an act of creation. So that's an important aspect to keep in mind of when you're creating a game. Make it unique, make it you, but come at it from an understanding that of games you like to play, right? What do you get enjoyment out of so you can unleash that same enjoyment, that same bit of flourishing? Here's an interesting question while we're still on the side on the right. Let's talk about control. Is control necessary to make a game? Like, think about when you play a game, right? Some games, like Tomb Raider, you know, the old and especially older games where the hardware wasn't there to really compensate for the big open worlds that we've designed today. Control, you're on a train track, right? You're on a train track the whole time. Everything is pretty much premeditated. You have very little room for decision making. There's a little bit, but most of it's twitch-based skill in the case of Tomb Raider, right? And how you're jumping on the platforms and shooting. But is control necessary to make a game? Do you have to have a certain bit of control and how much, right? So I think this is an important idea to grapple with, and I've come to the realization or the conclusion personally that it's a yes and no answer, and it's really about finding the right balance of control. If you look at the world around you, a lot of entropy in a system is generally bad. Building's going to fall down, right? Frameworks and structure keep things up, but too much and you're imprisoned, right? So you need a purpose-driven life. You need the freedom to find what makes you unique and what you enjoy and what you love. But then once you find that, you commit to it, and then you've put yourself on your own path. So as a creator, a good creator tries to take that same idea of player choice into the game by providing multiple avenues of attack for any one given situation. He also imparts talents, gifts, desires. These are all can be manifested in many different ways in a game. Everything from the hookshot in a Zelda game to, the Warglaives in God of War. So think about this weekend when you're creating your prototype. I would call it a prototyping weekend. Think about the guy on the right here and where he's coming from and all those parts that God possibly put into Adam at the moment of Genesis, you should be putting into your game. Gifts and talents, okay, how does that translate into mechanics and items? What about the structure of the game, the flow of it, right? Oh, that's the control, right? Do I have too much or too little? Think about what it means to be a good creator. And remember that the duty of the creator primarily is to steward or guide, delight, and imbue a lesson, right? And the best lesson, there has to be a sense of discovery to do that. You need to give the player the aha moment. And that's kind of that's the crux of game design, folks. That's the hard part. So moving on to the created, the left side. Now, here's my dilemma with this. And let's go to the crowd. Let's go to the audience. Is the game the left hand, or is it something else in the picture? What do you guys think? What is the game? I think it's the spark. I don't think it's the left hand. I think what Michelangelo is telling us and what this picture is trying to relate is a relationship. I would argue the left hand's the player. I would say that's the player. The spark of life not only is the game, the thing that is the actual created thing. But it's also the life source. If you think about how a player reacts to the game and what the game gives them, then it makes sense. But let's talk about being a player real quick. So the guy on the right, or the left, the guy on the left, Adam here, what makes a good Adam? Destiny? What do you think is a good characteristic of an Adam? Oops. My bad.
In the mind that he's the player?
Yeah, what makes a good player? I don't think it takes as much to be a good player as it does a good game designer. That could be argued, but I really only think there's a couple of things that it takes to be a good player. And I'm not even talking about skill level at the game. So when you make a game and you give it to someone, I call this the invitation of participation. You have to be a willing participant. You have to have some amount of reasonable suspension of disbelief. That's what you take a theater class here, Theater 101, they harp on that. You got to go in and you got to be like, you know, everything you're going to see for the next 2 hours, it's real life, unless it gets really wonky, right? All of that has to do with, you know, the entering into the absurd works when the absurd is consistent, right? What makes a game like Psychonauts or Katamari Damacy, if anyone remembers that game, PlayStation 2, where you rolled the ball, remember that? That was a cool game. What makes a game like Psychonauts something more... Well, let's take Mario. Mario's really quirky. You're jumping on shrooms, and you're fighting turtles with hammers, and I don't know what Bowser is, really, like, if you think about it. But what makes it still believable is its consistency. And there's meaning to everything, right? Even if it's simple, there has to be meaning. So as a player, you have to look for meaning. You have to have a willingness to suspend your disbelief, and you have to be willing to participate. So to me, those are the three things that make a good Adam, a good player, right? But those also help you make the game, right? You have to understand your audience. And if we're only going for those three things, you know, we have to be able to address them as a designer. So the first thing, the willingness to participate, the invitation to participate. Let's go to someone else. I've just been picking on you this whole talk. What's something that you kind of have to think about that you think would play into the invitation of participation? You know, I remember you too. Just, it doesn't have to be right. You don't have to be right or wrong. There's no really right or wrong answers.
You have to have the ability to play it.
It has to be playable, right? It has to look cool. I don't think anyone would play a game they show, you know, saw and was like, yeah, that's kind of... So when you're designing a game, it has to be enticing, right? You have to have... That kind of goes back to the uniqueness. And understanding of your own uniqueness as a player, I think, helps derive more value out of the game. It's a bit of a side note, but something worth thinking about. And it goes back to the fact there's hands on either side and they're both unique. Where we have the invitation of participation and the willingness to suspend disbelief. I think, more simply put, that just means keep an open mind. Play a lot of different stuff, right? Have breadth and depth. So, I think that's kind of all the time I'd like to spend on the player, the Adam. And I hopefully I gave you enough of a sense. I think that, like I said, the relationship between the two is the key part of the idea I'm trying to convey. And I think it's something worth thinking about this weekend as you make your game. The spark, right? It's extremely subtle in the picture, but it's the focal point, right? You almost can't even see it until you zoom in. But the spark is there. The spark is actually the game. It's the very... And I think this is, it's slightly poetic, right? It's slightly poetic that I'm equating the spark to the game, because video games are all electronic and it's a literal spark that's running it, right? 1958, Tennis for Two, first video game ever, just a bunch of simple transistors and resistors and I'm trying to think what he made it out of. I think he took apart an oscilloscope. William Higginbotham, by the way, first video game. If you learned anything from this talk, 1958, Tennis for Two, William Higginbotham. But what he did with that literal spark of life there has sparked this entire industry that we've come to love and we participate in. And I think the subtlety draws emphasis to the two hands, that the game itself is at the center, but it should fade into the back. Between the relation and what's happening is the relationship between the player and the creator. The created and the created is actually the spark. So the player and the creator, human and God, if you want. you and your audience. And the whole point of it, and the whole reason it's subtext, but it's the most important part of this painting, but it still fades into the back, is because you're trying to convey a message. You're trying to communicate. To me, that's the real reason you're here this weekend. You're trying to say something. You have an innate desire to communicate, and that's why we make games, and that's why we play, and we want to have fun. It's all communication, and we all seek to be in relation with one another. Humans are not made to be alone, people. We're not. So there are people who want to be alone more than others, and that's fine. You can be introverted. But at some point, I promise you, you're going to want to talk to someone or something, and if it's the walls, you know, they have help for that. But that's sort of, I guess, the key to the whole talk. Maybe I could have just skipped right there and said, hey, here's a picture. Make a game that's about a relationship with your player. All games are about that. And something to keep in mind this weekend as you're going about the busyness of making a game in 48 hours. God bless you, because that ain't going to be easy. But real quick, just to kind of wrap up, because I don't want to leave you completely hanging, I'm going to give you a few tips just to keep in mind to make sure you can get a game finished this weekend. Scope is important. That's a loaded word. It's a loaded term in software development. But keep it simple. Keep to the KISS standard, right? Keep it simple. Think of this as more of a prototype, a rapid prototype. Don't worry about having the cleanest, neatest, awesomest, sleekest code. Just get it to work, right? Or, you know, I don't think, does it have to be a video game, or can you do like a tabletop? So you can do a tabletop game. They don't have to code at all. And then focus on the mechanics above everything else, right? That's what's going to make the game fun. Even if it's just blocks and circles, if you have good mechanics, it's going to be fun. Animation, keep it simple. A static picture will work, or just two frames will work. I would avoid putting too much emphasis on that. And music and sound are really important, I think, but try to be judicious about that as well. You don't need footsteps. You don't need a lot of the background noise. But if sound has an important part of the gameplay, as like a cue, a door's closing, if that's an important part of the game, or picking up a power-up or something like that, put your emphasis on that. Cues. Draw, if the sound doesn't draw attention to something, you may want to forego it. That's it. I appreciate you guys listening. I would love to answer any more questions and or talk to you guys. We've got, 5 minutes? And you can check me out in my studio at ParableGameStudios.com. I'm also on Facebook and Twitter under the same name, ParableGameStudios.com, and or leave off the com. But I appreciate you guys listening. Thank you very much. Any questions, concerns, complaints?
Can you tell us real quick about the game you're making?
Sure. So, Young Sun is our first game. It's my first. I would call it my first full game. I would say everything I've made up until this point is just a prototype, very small. But I would say that's where you need to start. For your first game, some Super Mario Brothers seems very elementary to us these days, but I would say even that's far too big. Make one level of that for your first game, right? Keep it very simple. Understand the basics. I found it was harder than I thought, because I had visions of grandeur when I started to do all this, and I was like, no. It took a 50, 60-man team to make Final Fantasy X and some of these bigger games. There's no way one guy can do it. And it really is about teamwork. Work in teams, collaborate off each other. I'm getting off topic. But Young Sun is a mobile game. We've really focused on the mobile market because we feel it plays into kind of the size and style of game we're making with Parable. Short, sweet, to the point. It's a platformer. It's not an endless runner. It's a platformer on a phone. And it's set in a futuristic kind of world that's kind of cool, and has a comic book style vibe, and you are playing a boy who is running away from home to join a street gang. That's sort of the elevator pitch of it. So, but there's a moral to the story. If anyone's familiar with the parable of the prodigal son, it's kind of based off that. And yeah, look for it later this year, probably in the fall. So it's tough to people. I work for the state police full time as a programmer and database administrator. And then Jesse has a wife and a job as well. So it's very difficult finding time to work on the game, but we'll get it done.
Game jams often?
Do I do game jams?
Yeah.
Disclaimer, I've never done a game jam. I mean, like, I've never signed up and gone to do it, but, I mean, I've had assignments from Dr. Vanskoy where it's like, you know, 24 hours before it's due, and that was a game jam because I just did it. I did it in a day. So I passed, right? Yeah, cool. So, yeah, thank you. I'll stay around for a little bit.